What is up, heroes? This is Midnight Zero, and welcome back to Let's Play Professor Layton in the Curious Village Blind. In the last episode, we spent a lot of time walking around the village, talking to everybody we can before we continued upon our path to the mysterious tower. In this episode, we're finally going to approach the tower, explore new areas, etc. I'm very excited to do so. RoboPupper is telling us where we might find some hint coins, so naturally, we're going to click all over the place and not actually find I'm super hooked on this right now. I'm really enjoying the puzzles and the story, and I'm actually having to space out my recording sessions just so that my voice can recover. That's something in general I need to look into, so I don't strain my vocal cords, because that's not good, period. There's another hint coin. Can we go in this door? Oh, no we can't, but we found ourselves another hint coin. Is there really no... Okay, I was gonna say, are there no puzzles on this screen at all? But no, we found a hidden puzzle behind this sign. What puzzle is it? 119. Okay, so that brings it up to probably 120 is the total number of puzzles. The box below holds blue and red balls. As you can see, the color of the balls and the color of their respective areas don't match. Slide the balls around the box so that the red balls are in the red area and the blue balls are in the blue area. Okay. So, clearly, we're supposed to use this central area as a means of transit. However, we're gonna need to be careful, because if I were to just put the red where that blue ball was, then we have no choice but to undo one of those moves. So what we need to do is probably take one of the blues and push it over that way, like that. Although, I'm actually gonna restart, because I think we'll want to, as much as possible, move the, that's not what I wanted to happen. Alright, I'm gonna have to really carefully do this so it doesn't end my move early. We're gonna want to move one of the balls from up there. Or is that what we want to do? I actually may just want to... I wonder if it even really matters, admittedly. Come on. Come on. Why won't it come over? The thing is, like, I want to do it in as few moves as necessary. Why is it not coming over? Game. This is not the difficult part of the puzzle. Slowly, I guess, we will go. Now, if I were to bring this over here like that, then what? Right? Because now I need to make space, essentially, on the other side. So I'm gonna have to bring one of these back, and then I'm gonna have to kind of swap again, where I bring this red one out, and bring this blue one down. Like so. And now, I can bring a red one from up here, bring this over like that for now, because it doesn't really matter. And then we can slide this over here for now. And then we're gonna want to slide another one over. So we can slide this in here like that. What's going to be tough is getting rid of that top ball. Because now, well, what we're going to have to do is somewhat repeat the process, right? This is where things get complicated. This is definitely where things get complicated. 40 pick rats. Okay. I'm trying to think, how can I make an exchange between the red ball and the blue ball on top? I think what I'll need to do is bring this up here so I can bring that down like that, and then this so I can move that up there, and then this down here like that, and then up there. And do something like that. And I think I'm gonna need to repeat the process over here as well. Where I take a red ball and put it up there, and then can take this red ball down like that, move this blue up, can place this red down there because it's easier to move those around. And then I can similarly bring this blue, not, well, that's an extra move, but I don't want to redo everything up until this point. So we can move this down there like that. And then we can move, how are we gonna move you? Oh, yeah, we just move you like that, then up here, and then red ball here, then the blue goes back, like so. Then the red can go up, the blue goes over, and we're home free. All right,
how
so
does this sound?
37 moves. I think given touchscreen errors, would have really come to like 35 or 6, but the puzzle can be completed in 30 moves. Does that make you want to retry it? It does, actually. But I feel like if we just cleaned up some of those movements in the beginning, or figured out how to cycle those top and second from the top balls earlier, we would have been able to do that. But cool, that was a good one. I actually liked that one quite a bit. All right, with that now out of the way, I guess we'll head on forward? There wasn't a whole lot there. Oh, and we have another journal page that we're gonna find. Another note. Oh, what's on the ground? Oh, look at how ominous the tower is. It appears to be a scrap of paper. Can you please read what's written on it, Luke? Of course. Leave it to me, Professor. The boss hasn't been himself since Lady Violet's passing, and he shows no signs of recovering. That's why I've decided I'll make one as a tribute to Lady Violet. I'm sure it will put a smile on his face. Ah, yes, now it makes sense. Could our mystery author be... I've worked my fingers to the bone trying to cheer up the boss. Looking out over St. Mystere, I see a thriving, bustling village. With so many villagers to keep him company, maybe he can finally be happy again. That's the end of the page. Interesting. So it seems like there's a person in the tower who has literally created all of the villagers. Oh my goodness, all of the villagers are robots! All of the villagers are robots. That's totally the case. And they start to feel sick when their battery is running out or they, I don't know, need repairs or something like that. So the guy from the tower comes down and he abducts them and then repairs them and sends them back out. And he originally did so in order to help the Baron in his loneliness. And he created a Lady Dahlia in Lady Violet's likeness. So are all the villagers, or at least most of the villagers, robots then? At least the ones that have been kidnapped. As far as like the mysterious, you know, thudding noise, whatever, it's probably got to do with the construction or repair or whatever it may be of the robots, but... Oh boy. Oh boy. Professor, what's the matter? You look deep in thought. I can't confirm my suspicions at the moment, but I think it's safe to say this goes deeper than we thought. Yeah, I agree. Alright, who are you? Martha. Oh me, oh my. It's not every day I see a handsome buck around these parts. Your looks are impressive, dearie, but let's see if you got smarts. Try this puzzle on for size. Be happy to solve any puzzle you have, madam, but I don't believe we've met before. You are... You want to know my name, dearie? I'll tell you as soon as you solve this puzzle. Alright. Granted, the game already tells us, but... Alright, aces and the Joker. You've scattered a deck of 52 cards and one Joker face down on a table so that you don't know which card is where. Next, you start turning the cards over one by one. Assuming that you can't flip the same card twice, what are the percentage odds that you will turn over all four aces before you turn over the Joker? This seems... tough. Alright, well, let's think about the probability, right? So we're starting off with 53 cards. And basically what we need is any one of the four aces first, right? So our first would be 4 and 53, right? And then our second pull would be, assuming we get the second ace, whichever it may be, there are only 3 of them remaining, but now there are also only 52 cards remaining, so 3 of 52. This third pull would be 2 out of 51, then it would be 1 out of 50, and then it would be the Joker, right? Or rather, they just say before the Joker, not then the Joker, right? Assuming that you can't flip, what are the percentage odds that you will turn over all 4 aces before you turn over the Joker? Oh, so that makes it even more complicated. Because now it's not even that the 4 aces need to be the first 4 cards you flip over, they just need to be before the Joker whenever they occur. What's the best way to go about this? This seems way too complicated for Professor Layton. This seems like too complicated of a Professor Layton probability problem. So I'm probably overcomplicating things. I think it might be easier to say, what's 1 minus the probability that you flip over the Joker before you flip over the 4 aces, right? But even then, this seems really tough. Like, this seems really tough. So, one thing that comes to mind is that they don't say percentage chance or probability. They say percentage odds. And for those of you that don't know the definition of odds, it's not necessarily the probability of something happen. It's the ratio of the probability of something happening to the probability of, or to, I guess, like, the probability of it not happening. To 1 minus the probability of it happening. So, it's really the ratio, in this case, of the probability of getting the 4 aces to the probability of getting the Joker, I think. I think that might be what they're aiming for. That also seems a little bit more feasible, because obviously the probability of getting the Joker is 1 in 53. Whereas, well, even then, I mean, like I said, it would be 4 times 3, it would be 4 factorial over 53 times 52 times 51 times 50 for the 4 aces. But that would only be the first 4 on the first 4 draws. Yeah, I can't help but think that this is too complicated for a 40 Picarat question on a DS game intended for a broad audience. So I feel like there's something I'm missing. Yeah, I mean, this just seems massively complicated. Because you could say, okay, well, there's the chance the Joker is on the first, second, third, or fourth cards, and all of those would be, you know, you wouldn't have the intended result. So you could do like 1 minus those 4 probabilities, but then you also have to subtract the probability of, oh, getting the Joker on the fifth card, but only 3 of the aces were within the first 4 cards, and so forth. And similarly with only 2 aces in the first 4 cards, and only 1 ace in the first 4 cards. I get the impression it's going to be oversimplified and admittedly probably incorrect what they want the answer to be. I feel like what they are going to want the answer to be is, oh, the card, you know, the probability of getting one particular card is 1 in 53, and so getting 4 in a row is actually going to be 1/4 of that. it would be four times as unlikely. And so the odds will be 25%. But I don't agree with that. I think I'm actually going to take a hint here because how I see this as an actual probability problem seems way too complex. And I want to see... Out of 53 cards, 4 are aces. Each time you flip a card, the probability of turning over an ace increases. But you really don't need to work out any of that. Think about what you can do to eliminate other variables to consider. Think about what you can do to eliminate other variables to consider. I guess like, I don't really know what else you can do to get rid of other variables. Maybe the trick here is that the 52 cards are from one deck and the Joker is from a different deck. So it's actually 100% because you'll always flip every other card before you flip that Joker that is clearly, you know, has the back side of a different deck. Is that maybe what they're going for? I'm gonna go for another hint. If you distill this question down to its simplest form, it's just asking you how likely it is you'll flip over 4 aces in any order before you turn over the Joker. The other 48 cards have nothing to do with the problem. Really? Do the other 48 cards really have nothing to do with it? Maybe I need to brush up on how I'm thinking about this. And maybe there's a really good explanation of this online, but I don't necessarily see that. I want them to tell me more. Let's lay it all out on the table. There are 5 cards that actually matter. Of those 5, the Joker has to come last. What's the probability of flipping the Joker after the other 4 cards? I mean, that's the first thing I looked at, but I feel like I feel like the other cards matter. Well, I mean, like I said, the probability of getting 4 aces and then Joker would be 4 over 53 times 3 over 52 times 2 over 51 times 1 over 50 times 1 over 49. I guess if you're thinking in terms of all 53 cards. But I think when they say there are only 5 cards that actually matter, they want me to reduce that down to 5 cards. Because getting the order, you know, ace, 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 Joker is pretty unlikely when there are 48 other cards. So I think they actually want me to think of it in terms of there are like really only 5 cards, and it's 4/5 times 3/4 times 2/3 times 1/2, and then, well, there's only 1 card left after that, so that doesn't really matter. So it's just 4 factorial over 5 factorial, or 4 factorial, what? Over, yeah, 5 factorial. So that would be 1/5. Is that what they want me to do? I'll try it. I'm not really buying it, though.
There we go.
That's what they wanted.
Every puzzle has an answer.
Let's see the solution they give. Yeah, I guess I need to brush up on my probability here, because this is not clicking with me. I feel like those other cards matter. Yeah, so maybe I'll look this up some other time. It's what, puzzle number 102? Because I feel pretty mathematically inclined, and this seems, and while not everything is, that still doesn't mean everything is intuitive, you know, this definitely is not clicking well with me. Yes, indeed, that's right. Schmarte Andlusch, you're just the total package, aren't you? I'm Martha, and I just love Karsh, especially puzzles that use Karsh. Oh, those are my favorite-ish. I don't think I've mentioned how much I also enjoy the company of handsome gentlemen. Professor, don't we have somewhere to be right now? Luke, getting back on track. Much appreciated. Do you have any more puzzles for us? Any more card puzzles? Sorry, dearie, but I don't have any puzzles for right now. Okay, that's fine with me. I mean, if they're gonna be up the same vein, I guess I might as well see what was eluding me about that probability problem beforehand anyways. Alright, it's a hidden puzzle. What else we got? Number 117. I like that number. Painting a cube. In front of you sits a blank paper cube that you've decided to paint. You need to paint the cube so that all faces that touch are different colors. Using three colors of paint, how many ways can you paint the cube so that it satisfies the above condition? Each painting scheme should be a different pattern, not just the same pattern with the colors rearranged. Also assume that you can't leave any sides of the square blank. Okay. Alright, so we've got basically like 1, 2, and 3, right? Between the three different colors of paint. And so if I label one side 1, right? None of the adjacent sides can be 1. All faces that touch are different colors, right? So, all of these other sides can be 2 or 3. And then this far side can be 1 or 2 or 3. It can always be 1. And depending on whether the other sides are 2 or 3, then that'll affect whether or not it can be 2 or 3. So, as it stands, it seems like that would form 6 different patterns. And then, yeah, it seems after that they would just be rearranging. So if I were to make it like 2, well then obviously this could be 1 or 3, and then this could be 2, 1, or 3, depending on what the 1 and the 3 are, right? So I think the answer is going to be 6, just in terms of what possibilities we have. I think so, because that would technically be the same pattern, just rearranged colors, right? So I think that would give rise to 6 different patterns. Or not quite, actually, because depending on what you pick for the second one, it excludes certain options for the third one. So if we were to pick 2 for the second face, the faces adjoining the one face, we then only have 2 options, 1 or 3 for the other side, right? And if we were to choose 3 for the second face adjoining the one side, we only have 1 or 2. So I think that actually eliminates 2 of the potential options, and instead we're left with a total of 4. Yeah, I think that's all there is to it. Yeah, I'm gonna go with that. I think it's four. So, let's see.
I think I've got it.
Oh no! So we missed something.
I've let you down, Professor.
All rotated or color-swapped versions of a particular painting scheme count as the same pattern. Don't count them as separate patterns when tallying up the total number of possible solutions. All rotated or color-swapped. Did some of those count as color-swapped? Did some of them count like that? I thought that... I didn't think so. For example, let's see here. If it was like... 1, 2, 1, right? So there's like one on the left face that I have the one written on, and then we choose two, and then one for the side directly opposite the other one side. Would that be equivalent to 1, 3, 1 by this definition? Each painting scheme should be a different pattern, not just the same pattern with the colors rearranged. See, the thing is, with 1, 2, 1 versus 1, 3, 1, 2 and 3 are simply different colors, but it's not a rearrangement of previous existing colors. Because if... So I would consider 1, 2, 1 and 1, 3, 1 different patterns, not rearranged colors. I guess I should also explain that I'm only really concerned with three faces right now because the others kind of automatically fill in based on the other. They don't really have much flexibility, right? So whatever we choose for the first face, in this case number one, and then we choose a second number for the second face, and then that determines what the other faces need to be. Would it only be two then? I guess theoretically, right, if I were to do 1, 2, 1 versus 1, 3, 1, if I were to rotate the cube 90 degrees, they would be equivalent. When you look at how the other faces fill in, they would be the same. So it's actually only two then, I think. And it depends on whether or not the face diametrically opposite is one or not. Or is that the same too? Let's draw some cubes, right? So if we have our cube here, we have one, and then we have two, then this side must be three, right? And then we think about, what flexibility does this far side have? It doesn't have any, actually. It has to be one. I thought it would have more flexibility than it actually does, but it doesn't. And the thing is, it doesn't matter if I rotate this or anything like that, or if I were to choose, you know, the two and three to switch. No matter what, each cube side has to be, I guess, diametrically opposite or directly opposite aside from the same color. So every yellow needs to be on the opposite side of another yellow and so forth. And then it doesn't really matter how you rotate it. So maybe there's actually only one way. Maybe there's only one way. There's only one pattern, that is. basically that pattern. And then, yeah, so I'm actually gonna go with one. Wow, because yeah, I mean, if you rearrange the colors, there's no way to change that because it's just some rotation of the others.
Well, here's my guess.
There we go. Okay,
Professor,
so I definitely misunderstood that at first. Because I wasn't thinking about the other faces as much as I should have been. I was just thinking about what restrictions selecting one face would impose on a couple other key ones, but I should have considered the other faces too. I can do that puzzle standing on one foot. I'm happy for you, Luke. I'm happy for you. Anything up here? Hint coin. They seem to be becoming more and more relevant. Do we have anything else? Can we go in this window, this door? No? Okay. Another hint coin. Lovely. Then I guess we'll keep on going this way. I think this is a dead end. And this does appear to be the only road, doesn't it? Gosh, that tower sure looks awfully ominous, doesn't it? Seeing it up close, I can understand why the villagers are so scared of the place. Let's take a closer look at this wall. There might be more to it than meets the eye. Ah, I knew it. It's a transformer.
What?
And who might you be?
And who might you be?
Well, I'd rather not say.
Said the same thing.
Huh? Why not? What are you hiding?
We seek access to the tower. Do you think you could help us, miss?
The tower?
Oh, wait!
Whoa. What in the world was that about? Yeah, my thoughts exactly, Luke. That was so weird. So obviously the evil guy was there. Maybe he's trying to gain access to the tower himself. And she sensed his presence or something like that. She kind of looked like Flora / Violet. So maybe that's relevant? I don't know. Huh? Is it the park? Professor, what's this? A Ferris wheel ticket? Very curious indeed. Luke, that girl may have dropped this to tell us where we should head next. But why would she want to help us? Your guess is as good as mine, Luke. Still, I can't shake the feeling that she's trying to help us. Well, your intuition hasn't ever been wrong. Let's see what we can find around the park's Ferris wheel. That's right, Layton. Go straight to the park. You've been a thorn in my side for too long. I think it's about time for you to disappear. Uh-oh, we've got quite the confrontation coming. For good? For good? Excuse me, Mr. Evil Man, but I know that there are sequels to this game. So, whatever plan you're scheming, it ain't gonna work, bud. Wow, and so with that, we've already finished up Chapter 6. Wow, that flew by. Well, it looks like we're finally gonna head to the park, which is exciting. Is there anything to investigate here? No puzzles hidden in any nooks, crannies, corners? Anything of the light? I mean, clearly we're gonna break through this wall at some point. Can we go anywhere else? No? We've technically cleared Chapter 6, so I do want to talk to her to see if she has any more puzzles for us. Doesn't seem to be the case, though. Can we go in here? No? Alright. Oh! RoboPupper is telling us where we can find ourselves another hint coin. Thank you so much. I'm sure we have a surplus of them, but can't hurt. Any more to find? Sure, we'll take that hint coin. But otherwise, yeah, I'm very concerned about going to the park. RoboPupper is helping us out, as usual. Let's chat with our friends here. Giuseppe? No, the same old pun. Let's see if Agnes has anything new to say. Might as well check along the way, right? It seems that destiny has decided that I show you this puzzle. Will you triumph, or will the gaping maw of fate swallow you whole? Okay. So this is why I talk to everyone again, and over and over. The wire cube. Wow, just a lot of cubes. You want to create a cube out of metal wiring using the fewest number of wires possible. You can bend each wire as many times as you like, but no portion of the cube can have more than one length of wire running over the same edge. Don't worry about how one wire will connect to the next, because you'll use a soldering iron later on. What's the fewest number of wires required to complete the task described above? Okay, so... at first glance, can we draw? We can. So what we can do is start to use our, we can actually trace out a lot of these. I think so long as we don't go back, we'll be okay. So it's one of those things where it's like, that was one there. And now we would need a second, we would need a third, and then we would need a fourth. I think that's it. Let's try this one other way, though, now that it comes to mind. If we were to go like one, you know, all the way up like that, and then we go around and kind of cover a second face like that. Could we do it with even fewer cube parts? No. Because even then, we're going to go up here, and that'll be our second wire, and then again, we'll need a third and a fourth. This seems like a really cool math problem. Proving that it has to be four, right? It's got to be some intrinsic property of the cube. Because, yeah, I mean, what I did before, right, was basically what I'm doing here. If I say, oh, I could go across... and then come down, and then I could make another set. But again, I'm still gonna have those three remaining pillars. So I think it's four. Four wires. Unfortunately, I feel like I got that too quickly. I'm gonna try it. Because I think that's correct. But, okay. I felt like I almost got that too quickly for it to be the solution. But hey, look at that. We got an even 3,000. You need four wires to make the cube. Three straight lines make up each of the cube's eight corners. At least one wire must terminate at each corner. Since there are eight corners, you'll need eight wire ends to form things properly. That's pretty cool. That's pretty cool. That seems like a really neat geometry problem to explore. Goodness, I can't believe you solved it. It was meant to be. I tell you what, since you went and solved my puzzle, I'll read your palm. Give me your hand now. It seems that calamity follows you wherever you go. Try your best to stay out of harm's way. Why, thank you. Well, we'll give the globe to Luke. For now. Any painting piece? No? Okay. Let's see how each of them likes the globe. Luke, how happy are you with the globe? Neat. Now I can brush up on my geography. How do you feel about it, Layton? Suppose I might give it a spin once in a while. Nah, it's definitely for Luke then. Alright, was there anything else we got? I thought we got more, but no, I guess not. We've already gotten all the gizmos. We've solved 95 puzzles. It's rather impressive. Let's head to the right then, and then we can head down. Talk to Gerard. He said he had more puzzles for us. We'll see if now is the time. Nope, not now. Alright, Prosciutto, do you have anything for us? Just kind of making the rounds, you know? Checking out on all the village's residents. I've got it all figured out, you know? The best times in life are when you're eating good food. Nom nom nom. I certainly agree that some of the best would be such situations. Is there anyone in the bar? Nope. Or the cafe, I should say. This is a, is this rated E? I feel like it is, or at the very least should be. We're probably starting to exhaust a lot of the puzzles that the characters may give us, the villagers may give us. Let's see. Hello again, are you here to take another look at my desk? No, but that's okay. I'll spare the cat and mouse. Actually, no, I'm too curious. I would regret not checking when it seems like it's, what's it called? Just easy to check. The people haven't changed I guess, like, where they're standing too much, but do not be alarmed by my piercing gaze. This is for research purposes only. Yeah, I think, for the most part, we're probably fine. It's mostly when people, like, change positions and everything, that's when the puzzles reset and all that. So I think I'll just keep going for now. We can finally go to the park. Are we gonna go in? This park has been closed every time we've come by. Why do you suppose that is, Professor? I haven't the foggiest idea. Perhaps we should ask someone at the town hall. It's probably closed for some, you know, devious reason. Does the park hold the way into the tower? Search the park grounds to find out. Okay. We'll save our progress then. And continue on. So now we're supposed to go to the town hall, correct? And now we've technically entered a new chapter, so now I want to talk to all of the different people and see all the different puzzles they may have. Again, I feel like we've exhausted some of the villagers in terms of what they can actually offer. For example, Flick at least tells you, but maybe Crouton doesn't. Fresh out of puzzles, etc. Yeah, I feel like we found most of the puzzles that they can actually offer, and because it looks like it might only be a total of 120 puzzles left, and we still have new areas to explore that will probably have hidden puzzles, and there are obviously a couple people that still have puzzles for us. They've alluded to it at the very least. We've also now gone to Chapter 7, and I didn't see any puzzles added, or it mentioned, you know, this puzzle was sent to Granny Riddleton's. And sure enough, we go here and there aren't any, so I think we did a pretty comprehensive job last time. Now, the question is, where is the town hall? It's not in the inn, is it? We can let Beatrice know that we didn't really find that person, but we're on the lookout. I'm counting you to catch the no-good. Okay. Thanks. We're still on the case. We can head back towards our car again. Nothing seems to be out of the ordinary. Where is the town hall, though? Right? Talk to the town hall official. Oh, that's Rodney, isn't it? The document guy. Rodney, help us out. What's that you say? The gate to the park is locked shut? No, that's impossible. We've employed a caretaker who should have everything up and running. Be that as it may, the gate is locked shut, and we can't gain entrance to the place. Would you please open it for us? That sort of thing is the job of the park caretaker. I strongly advise you to go find him, whoever may that be. Well, where do you think we might find this caretaker? Now that's a good question, isn't it? Managing the park is the caretaker's duty, but who knows who manages the caretaker? I can't say, it's not one of my duties. What a bureaucracy! He manages the town sewer systems as well. Now, unless you have some form you need to fill out, I strongly advise you to beat it. Gosh, he's rude. Yeah, no kidding. The sewers, unpleasant as it might be, it is one place we haven't searched yet. Perhaps we will find a clue to our mystery down there. I've only seen one manhole in town. Oh, right, the one on the path to the park. Well, it's a dirty job, but someone has to do it. Off we go. Oh, neat, so we're going to be going into the sewers. I have really only been in sewers in video games when it's like a horror game or something like that. Or something like Batman, where you're going after Killer Croc. And, oh, you can see the manhole is open. So we'll click on that. Oh, do we have to click on the boot? So now we're down here. And listen to that music change. We can explore around quite a bit. Ooh, I'm excited. Let's see who you are. Excuse me, are you by any chance the park caretaker? Pavel. No. I'm an explorer of El Mundo. Right now I'm trying to familiarize myself with the local culture. Ah, and you're doing so from underground? Well, please pardon my mistake then. Have a pleasant day, sir. Oh, wait, for one momento. I don't know French, obviously. I just saw a man in work clothes pass here. Could he be the caretaker you see? He could be. Which way did he go? Probably to the right. Pero, maybe it was the left. I see. Are you feeling alright? You seem a bit directionally challenged for being an explorer. I just arrived here after years of world travel. Something local geography, that's all. I see. In that case, please forgive me for making another assumption. Now please excuse us, as we need to get going. Wait, which way to the village? Where's the train station? What a character. All right, so I think... Oh, RoboPupper helping us out find these hint coins. Is there anything else hidden around here? The ladder? No puzzles from the ladder? Okay. Which way do we want to go? Left? Right? Whatever may it be. Let's head to the left first. Oh, and we've got Stashin? Scarfin down here? What's he doing down here? Okay, well, don't you look surprised. I bet you didn't expect to see me in a place like this, eh? The river that encircles most of St. Mysterio is right past this pipe. But don't you begin ideas, you can't cross it. Give up on those ridiculous notions of returning to the rest of the world and settle down here. I suppose it's a tough transition to make. Here's a puzzle to help you get situated. Huh. Interesting. Okay. Well, I guess we'll take it. In preparation for your big move, you've packed your belongings into 20 boxes and arranged them as shown below. With everything packed, you are now ready to label each box with its contents. In order to do so, though, you'll need to move a few boxes around. How many of the boxes can't be labeled without rearranging the stacks? Okay, so basically it's asking, how many hidden blocks are there? can I draw? I can. Lovely. So, there are 20 boxes. And the other thing is we kind of have to imagine where the boxes that we can't visibly see are, because we can't, like, rotate the diagram, right? But at first glance, there's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. 14. So there are 6 we can't see currently. There are 6 we cannot see currently. However, not all of those are necessarily hidden. For example, this box here, this box here, there's a box underneath it, but there's nothing to the right of it over here, so it is exposed and can be labeled, even though it's not one of the ones we were able to count at first. So we need to decide how many there are that can't be labeled at all. And it's a bit tougher than I expected. So there's definitely this box here. There's one underneath this that cannot be labeled because it has a box on this side of it, it has a box on this side of it, and this side, and under and on top, right? But for example, the box that's under this one can be labeled, the box that's under this one can be labeled. All of the ones in this tower can be labeled. So it's none of those. The question is, so all of the ones underneath this one here, underneath this one, cannot be labeled because they have towers on all sides of them. So there are 2 that cannot be labeled there. And then we look at this tower here. There's one underneath there that cannot be labeled because it's surrounded on all sides. Everything in this tower can be labeled. Everything in this tower can be. Everything in this tower can be. This one can. This one can. This one can. This one can, etc. So I think it's actually only going to be 3. I think it's going to be 3 boxes that cannot be labeled, that are not that don't have any side exposed to our person with a marker trying to label things. And again, I think there are 6 that we cannot see, right? For example, this tower here has a height of 3, but we can't see the final bottom box. And then this one has a height of 3, but we can't see 2 of them. This one has a height of 3, but we can't see 2 of them. And then this one has a height of 2, but we can't see 1 of them. And that would be your total of 6. So in that case, with that, we've accounted for all of the boxes that are possible. So I think it's going to be 3. Just trying to make sure in my head. Yeah, let's go with 3. There are 3 boxes that do not have any faces exposed to our guy trying to label things. All right.
Another puzzle solved.
30-30. Another nice number. Quite right. Alright, yeah. So we're good. We're good on that. Well done. I like the way you get all fired up over puzzles. You're my kind of guy. So hurry up and get settled already. Saint Mystere is happy to have you. It's a little aggressive. Can we actually continue on that way? Oh, we can. Okay, so there's... Oh, there's something hidden there, too. Is there a puzzle going to be hidden, like, underwater or in the vines or something like that? I don't know. But regardless, we have now solved 96 puzzles. And of course, we're going to continue exploring the sewers, the river, our... whoever might be the caretaker we find underneath here in the next episode. I hope you guys enjoyed this one. There were definitely some cool puzzles. Definitely got tripped up with a couple of the cubes. And nevertheless, it was a lot of fun, though. And I can't help but think we're getting closer and closer to discovering who this villain is and uncovering lots of the secrets and getting to some of what will probably be the hardest puzzles. And I'm really excited. But until the next episode, this is Moon Knight Zero, and this mission is complete.